हेलो, आर यू हियर मी? प्राची तन्ना
यस सर,
और हो? ओके,
गुड इवनिंग एंड अ वार्म वेलकम टू एवरीवन प्रेजेंट हियर, ऑल द डिग्निटरीज एंड द एंथुसियास्टिक पार्टिसिपेंट्स। एज वी ऑल नो, वी हैव गैदर्ड हियर ऑन दिस वंडरफुल ओकेशन फॉर एन इनसाइटफुल एक्सपीरियंस ऑन द टॉपिक ऑफ ग्लोबल सस्टेनेबल डेवलपमेंट, रोल ऑफ साइंस, टेक्नोलॉजी एंड इनोवेशन। First of all, I would like to give a brief introduction of our guest of honor, respected Dr. Rajgopala Chidambaram. A hearty welcome to you, sir. It
Thank
is our
you.
pleasure to have you here.
Thank you. Thank you.
Dr. Chidambaram, a Padma Shri and Padma Vibhushan awardee, has played the role of director of Bhabha Atomic Research Center from 1990 to 1993, and he has also been the key contributor in India's nuclear weapon programs like Pokhran 1 and Pokhran 2. I would like to request the Dean of our faculty, Professor Arun Pratap, to give a gracious welcome to our guest of honor.
Am I audible?
Yes, sir, you are audible.
Yeah. So this Paramarsh program is purely organized by students of the Faculty of Technology and Engineering, the Maharaja Sayajirao University of Baroda. It's their program organized by them, where they invite one of the very successful dignitaries to this program. I remember Dr. A.S. Kiran Kumar, former chairman ISRO, and then Dr. Kakodkar. I think they have graced the occasion already in this particular program. This is one of the three key programs organized by the students of the faculty, Footprints, Prerna and Paramarsh. It's very difficult to say which program is better than which the other program, because all these programs are nicely organized by them. As the name suggests, Paramarsh, they try to follow the footprints, but then they go by the advice of and the suggestions or the guidance of a very key person in the country who has played a key role in the development of the country, in all successful innovative programs or the technological programs. And it's a pleasure today to have none other than Professor R. Chidambaram, from ex-director, Bhabha Atomic Research Center, and Padma Vibhushan, Padma Shri. He will guide all the students in the direction where they want to, if they want to go, they should go, or they may choose their own way. But the role or the suggestions of the dignitary today, Professor R. Chidambaram, is a very important role. And I hope the students will listen to him carefully. He is a very lucid orator. He talks in a very nice way, and you can, anybody can understand. I have heard him so many times. I have got this fortune to hear him many times. He being a physicist, top physicist of the country, not only country, but abroad also, playing very key role in Department of Atomic Energy and in many programs, as you told, Pokhran 1 and 2. So I welcome you, sir, in this program, and I appreciate the students' efforts to have you here, sir, among us. It will be a pleasure to listen to you again, sir. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Professor Arun Pratap.
It's my pleasure, sir.
Very interesting, your definition of Paramarsh. You know, Alfred North Whitehead, you know, once said, talking about university education, age has experience, youth has imagination, and the purpose of university education is to transfer knowledge without destroying creativity. So as Professor Arun Pratap correctly said, you listen to me but don't agree with everything that I say. You make up your own mind whether you agree with what I'm saying, not agreeing. You don't have to insult me for that, but I'm saying, just keep it in the back of your mind. Now, shall I start the presentation? I'll start the PowerPoint.
Sure, sir.
Share screen. This one. Wait, this Are you able to see the slide, Prachi?
Yes, sir, it's clear.
And also hear my voice?
Yes, yes, perfectly audible.
Okay. See, this is the title I decided to speak on today. And of course, I've been to your university, MS University, many times over the years, though not very, very recently, of course. I'm a physicist, as Dr. Arun Pratap said, and I used to visit the Department of Physics. Of course, now MS University has an extensive range of facilities, ranging from arts and science, technology, engineering, medicine, management, and also an institute of fashion technology. And it is accredited with A grade. So it's my pleasure to give a webinar guest lecture in Paramash, and I'm grateful to Jeffy Johnson for inviting me to give this talk. See, these are the 17 sustainable development goals given by the United Nations in 2015, and their aim at that time was, he's talking about globally, by 2030, there should be no poverty, zero hunger, good health and well-being, quality education, gender equity, and so on. You know, if you look at it, of course, many of them are interrelated. And as you can see, firstly, the definition of sustainable development. It has been defined as development which meets the needs of the present without compromising the ability of future generations to meet their own needs. So we have to take care of that. That is what is meant by sustainable development. Of course, this sustainable development, which was progressing fairly well, I'm told, pretty well actually, in all the countries of the world, has had a very bad setback due to the COVID pandemic. And if you look at the literature, they talk about, this is a co-chair of the Sustainable Development Solutions Network. Last week he has said, COVID-19 has unleashed a near perfect sustainable development goal storm across the world. And they are now feeling it will possibly delay implementation of the SDGs beyond 2030. Of course, it has proceeded to disrupt good health and access to health services. National economy is into deep distress. Livelihood has been badly hit for people who are particularly daily wage earners, and consequently worsen poverty. That was SDG 1. Food insecurity, hunger has increased. Education system has been affected. Though, of course, daily education has got a boost, e-classes and all that, which probably have a positive impact in the long term. And everything else. But interestingly, it has had some positive impact. One positive impact I myself find is people have gone digital. All payments are now made electronically, not by cash, more or less. That's one thing. And then, for example, the carbon dioxide emission has come down. Carbon dioxide. And maybe air and water have become cleaner, possible to take measures. Can you take these measures even after COVID is gone? Because COVID will go away one of these days. Exactly when nobody is very sure about. If people follow the same discipline, the people who used to get maids to clean up their house, now they find if they litter, they have to do the cleaning. So cleanliness in the house has gone up, and that has a fallout on what you do to the environment. World Health Organization has also looked at it, and they also have a focus on sustainable health decisions. See, you should make decisions that are made in the present which do not compromise future needs. And one thing, of course, is the COVID-19 pandemic shows that sustainable development goes beyond national strategies. Because every individual needs to make health decisions that meet personal needs as well as the needs of the broader community. But national decisions can come sometimes compromise. See, India of our dreams, particularly young guys like you from MS University who are listening to this, we want an India which is economically developed, scientifically advanced, and militarily strong. For us, the sustainable development goals are only the beginning. We want India to become a developed country, and then you want to become a knowledge economy in the shortest possible time. We dream of an India, particularly you young guys, where the Human Development Index, which is defined by the United Nations in terms of three parameters, per capita GDP, life expectancy at birth, and education levels, you want India to be among the top 10 countries of the world. This has to be backed by science. For that, we have to be scientifically advanced. We need excellence in basic research, including what I have called directed basic research, not directed by anybody, but directed by India's needs in the long term. We want excellence in applied research, technology development, R&D-led innovation. And all of this has to be backed by high-quality manufacturing skills. We also need an appetite for risk-taking, particularly you young guys who aspire to become leaders. If you don't take risks, of course, risk after taking suitable, making an assessment of what is the economic or other benefit you get out of this, is it worth taking, techno-economic feasibility of anything that you want to do. But then, as this, there's a beautiful book called This Idea is Brilliant, edited by John Brockman. He has written a companion book which says, This Idea Must Die. And in that book, Philip Rosenweiss says, when it comes to technological breakthroughs or launching new products, it is better to act and fail than fail to act. And then, of course, we want to be militarily strong with the ability to fight and win conventional wars, crush perpetrators of low-intensity conflicts, and with the capability for nuclear deterrence. This is the Human Development Index I mentioned to you about. UN calculates it on the basis of these parameters. But I've shown 20 years back that the better parameters for a country like India is the per capita electricity consumption and female literacy. Education index, or before that they had adult literacy. I prefer female literacy because two things. One, female literacy correlates very strongly with infant mortality and birth rate. Higher the female literacy, the lower is the infant mortality. the higher the female literacy, the lower is the birth rate. Of course, fortunately, India is doing pretty well on this count. Female illiteracy is coming down, and accompanying it, the fertility rate is coming down. Fertility rate compared to two generations back come down very substantially, only about 2.1 or so, little over 2.1. 2.1 is the replacement fertility rate. And if you plot that against per capita electricity consumption, you find, and of course the x-axis is the logarithmic axis, it is an S-shaped curve. And we are somewhere in the middle of that long middle line. And we want to go at least to the cusp of that curve. That means our per capita electricity consumption has to go up by at least 5 to 6 times. Of course, we want energy security, not just energy availability now, sustainably so. That is what is meant by energy security. So the electricity consumption must grow substantially in India. But then we have also got to take care of climate change, global warming. There is an international panel on climate change, and it is now reported that the globe has warmed by about 1 degree compared to the early periods of the Industrial Revolution. And the measures to mitigate this in the future, the IPCC wanted it to limit to 2 degrees, now they want to limit to 1.5 degrees. Particularly in terms of for energy production, you must go to renewable energy, nuclear, and carbon capture and storage, including bioenergy and with carbon capture. Now, all the assessment, of course, the new report is due anytime now. It will only confirm this, because of course we'll get a much better integrated data. See, there was a Stanford University study last year. What it says in the short term, since the 60s, if you look at it, inequality has increased. The cold countries like Norway and Sweden, their economy has benefited, while hot countries like India and Nigeria, warm countries, their economy has gone down. But if the snow and ice have started diminishing and sea level is rising, long term all countries are going to be affected badly. And this realization is there now. And in that you see the role of nuclear. If you take the comparison of lifetime, life cycle emissions, of course natural gas is better than coal. Biomass in the sense that it recycles. You grow the biomass, then you burn it. Solar is good, and nuclear is even better in terms of hydro is very good in terms of life cycle CO2 emission, and CO2 is a very important greenhouse gas. That's why nuclear power is very important. And the World Economic Forum, they meet once a year in December in Switzerland. And they claimed, of course, they have not allowed it. The COVID had not come. COVID has had a very interesting impact. Renewable energy demand has gone up, but other demands, but that is a passing phase. You shouldn't worry too much about COVID in the longish term. Electricity demand is increasing because electricity is the most convenient form of energy. Overall energy use compared to that, electricity use is doubling. Nuclear power 10% and of the world's electricity in OECD countries even higher. At the moment there are 450 operating reactors, and of course, we had the problem with Fukushima after that, but even Japanese are going back to nuclear slowly. And 30 This is the recent report, World Nuclear Association. 30 countries are considering planning or starting nuclear power programs, range from sophisticated economies to developing nations, Bangladesh, Turkey. UAE has already started this program. India has had a very well thought out three-stage program. First stage, heavy water reactors using natural uranium as fuel. Use natural uranium and fuel, you have to use heavy water because it's not a big neutron absorber. Heavy water as coolant and moderator that slow down the fission neutrons. And that produces plutonium, which will be used for fast breeder reactors. And these reactors produce more fuel than they consume. That's why they are called breeders. And then you expose thorium there. And in this last stage, third stage, after we have built a sufficient number of fast breeder reactors, thorium-232 gets converted to uranium-233 in fast breeder reactors. Just like uranium-238 gets converted to plutonium-239 in pressurized heavy water reactors. This is our three-stage program. But to accelerate availability of nuclear power, we are also building light water reactors with international cooperation. We don't have much experience in this, though we have built the nuclear submarine reactor as a light water reactor. First reactors are the what we call VVER reactors of Russia, which are shown in this figure, which we have built 1,000 megawatts, and more are under consideration. And this is what is called the closed nuclear fuel cycle. You have to mill and mine uranium, fabricate the fuel, design and build nuclear reactors, take the valuable plutonium out of that, remaining goes as nuclear waste, radioactive waste, and then you have to store it. This is called the closed, if you recycle the plutonium, it's called the, otherwise also it's called the nuclear fuel cycle, but now it is called the closed nuclear fuel cycle. And India is one of the few countries in the world which has comprehensive capability in the nuclear fuel cycle. Of course, we have had problems in the sense of technology control regimes which prevented collaboration. Very first reactor, we bought PSWR 220 megawatt, was from design, Canadian design, CANDU reactor, 220 megawatt, built in Rajasthan. And then we slowly, over a period of time, we indigenized it. Then we built 540 megawatt reactors. Now we built 700 megawatt reactors, PSWRs, pressurized heavy water reactors. Now we are leaders in the world in pressurized heavy water reactors. And one day I'm sure we'll be leaders in fast breeder reactors and later in the thorium uranium 233 cycle. There is an interesting book by Nassim Nicholas Taleb. He has written Anti-Fragile, Things That Gain from Disorder. He says, If something is fragile, it breaks under stress. If it is robust, it resists stress. But he uses the word anti-fragile to talk about things which become stronger under stress. There are some bacteria, for instance, which become stronger under antibiotic, resistant to antibiotics. And I have said this is also true of our nuclear program. We talk about Atmanirbharta today. Thanks to the technology denial regime, we became Atmanirbhar in nuclear. Of course, nobody is Atmanirbhar in every facet of every type of reactor. Nobody needs to. In fact, when I was director of BARC, I defined self-reliance as immunity against technology denial. As we became stronger, people realized there is no point in pressurizing us. And now the nuclear supplier group guidelines have been relaxed for India, even though we are not signatories to the NPT. And now uranium is freely available to us from abroad and also some equipment. Of course, there are conditions. We know we can build enough of our own reactors, but if you import and put it, then it goes under what we call international safeguards. In fact, many countries' nuclear has slowed down, but one day they have to come back. If they are really serious about cutting down carbon dioxide emissions and serious about pushing back climate change. And at that time, only a couple of countries, India is one of them, will have all this technology. That's why I used to tell my Western friends some years back, we need you in the short term. And later you are going to come to us for this technology. See, if you close the nuclear, the advantage of closing the nuclear fuel cycle as India is doing is that same uranium, you know, uranium, as some of you young guys may know, less than 1% is uranium-235, which undergoes fission in a pressurized heavy water reactor. In light water reactors, normally we raise that less than 1% to about 3% for enriched uranium. But the remaining, in the case of PSWR, 98-99% plutonium becomes plutonium when exposed in a reactor. U-238 picks up a neutron, emits a couple of beta rays, which outside become electrons. That increases the atomic number by 2, and 92 uranium-238 becomes 94 plutonium-239. And if you are able to close the nuclear fuel cycle by putting that uranium, plutonium into new reactors, that's what I showed you, closed nuclear fuel cycle, the same uranium will give you 50 times more power. Similarly, if you close the nuclear fuel cycle with thorium, the same uranium will give you 600 times more power. So in fact, I was talking to Dr. Mohammad Elbaradei, my friend, the former Director General of the International Atomic Energy Agency. Then he asked me, if it is so, can we call nuclear as renewable energy? I said, we'll be modest and we'll call it near renewable energy. Of course, there is also 3 parts per billion uranium in seawater, but it's not yet economically viable to extract. 0.016% of hydrogen atoms in water are heavy hydrogen atoms. I'll show you a slide later. You know, if we break up a uranium atom by pumping neutrons into it, the resultant fragments have less mass than uranium plus neutron. And this deficit in mass gets converted to energy using the Einstein equation, E is equal to mc squared, c of course velocity of light. In a similar way, if isotopes of hydrogen join together and fuse, the resultant particles have less mass than what we started with. And again, you apply Einstein equation and you get energy. That is what is called fusion energy. In fact, as many of you or some of you may know, what we call solar energy when it comes to Earth is really produced by fusion in the sun to start with. These are the operating nuclear power plants in India, 6,780 megawatts, including in Kaiga, which is not far from Surat. And these are the reactors under construction. Now, either we'll go for 700 megawatts. The government fortunately has given sanction for 10 reactors, 700 megawatts, in a fleet mode, and then at the Kodankulam 3 and 4, first two were 1,000 megawatt, next two will add that. So these are the 6,700 megawatt reactors which are projects under construction, which includes a 500 megawatt prototype fast breeder reactor. Come to that in a moment. This is the fast breeder reactor program. We are one of the countries in the world which has extensive experience in fast reactors. We built a small reactor, fast breeder test reactor. It was actually with the French collaboration. 40 megawatt thermal. Now we have added 13.5 megawatt electrical. It has reached the full power, and it has been working from 1985. This is under construction. And then we may change the fuel, the MOX fuel from uranium, PO2, that was carbide fuel. And later we may go to metallic fuel. Third stage, first start with thorium fuel, produce uranium-233, and later go to uranium-233 thorium cycle. Because we have built smaller research reactor. Kamini has been operating for, 30 years in Kalpakkam. And the advanced heavy water reactors designed in Bach is called an advanced reactor because it has passive safety feature. And it also utilizes thorium. And there are other kinds of reactors under development, molten salt reactors, high temperature reactors, acceleration driven systems, and so on. This is for the imported reactors. Of course, agreements are on, except with the, apart from the Russian, which I showed you earlier. These are all in the discussion stage. You know, if you have to, many projects for sustainable development, very big project. You see, I'll say in a slide later, India's technology needs range from nuclear to rural. And some of them are very multidisciplinary projects. Of course, in the mission-oriented agencies like atomic energy or space or DRDO, it is possible that all these multiple disciplines are available with one department, but sometimes not. For example, design of a nuclear power plant done entirely by atomic energy. Light combat aircraft Tejas by the DRDO, or space launch vehicles by ISRO. Their examples are all disciplines being available within an institution. But Pokhran test of 7498, where DAE, DRDO, and armed forces were involved, or the taking up of the advanced ultra supercritical thermal plant. Now, when I was the principal scientific advisor, we started this plan. See, whatever you say, next 20, 30 years, people are going to burn coal. But if we're able to raise the temperature of the steam beyond 700, for the same amount of carbon dioxide produced, you can produce more power. That is why it is a relatively cleaner coal-based plant. And here you have to bring together IG Kar, who are an expert in materials, Indira Gandhi Center for Atomic Research, BHEL, Bharat Heavy Electricals, and NTPC, which is a utility. And you know, nuclear weapons also part of nuclear program. And this is a Venn diagram. Wherever two countries have shared knowledge or some spying has taken place or whatever, this is how it goes. And this is done by a couple of Americans soon after our test. And here they say that India stands alone. Indian nuclear weapons program, we didn't get knowledge from anybody, nor did we feel the need to spy on anybody to get information. As I said, nuclear is not just electricity and weapons. Practically no field of societal activity in which nuclear does not come one way or another. Food preservation, producing new radiation mutants, diagnostics of diseases by using radio tracers, cancer treatment by using radiotherapy, water resources, even in a village in Uttarakhand, we use the isotope hydrology technique, DIGNI, developed by Bach to increase the recharge of aquifers, and so on, radiography. See, we also got our reactors checked by IAEA. This is an OSAC mission of the International Atomic Energy Agency. And look at their report of the Rajasthan 3 and 4 reactor. Open communication, enthusiasm, motivation, and sense of ownership were observed at all levels during the OSAC mission. Any project, running any facility, or even in maintaining your own university, unless everybody there has a sense of ownership, it will not work very well. And they found these attributes in that they say leads to a strong safety culture at Rajasthan Reactor 3 and 4. And I always say safety and reliability go together, whether it is your personal car or a nuclear reactor. If your car doesn't give you trouble, no problem with brakes or steering, and everything is maintained properly, then it is, if it is reliable, very unlikely you will ever get into an accident. In the same way, see, look at this. On December 10, 2018, the indigenously built Unit 1 of Kaiga, that's in Karnataka, because all our reactors work well. In fact, all our reactors have worked well during this COVID times also, by the way. This reactor, on May 13, 2016, when it hit 941 days, it broke the world record, which was being held by a nuclear power station of the United Kingdom. Of course, after 962 days, they had to shut it down for maintenance. The International Atomic Energy Agency, we collaborate with them very strongly, interact with them, and the Director General before Mohammed, after Mohammed, Albarade Yuki Amano, and he came here and he had commented, and I'd like to read it for you. I'd like to conclude by noting that India's remarkable success in the field of peaceful nuclear technology is an inspiration for many developing countries. I also appreciate India's willingness to serve as a mentor for other Asian countries that have recently joined. We collaborate under the aegis of IAEA with many developing countries. And he adds, India is at the forefront of technological development in the nuclear sector, not least the area of fast reactors. I told you about that, and related fuel cycles, which are important, as I explained to you, for the long-term sustainability of nuclear power. We also have in Haryana a global center for nuclear energy partnership, and there are courses run by us, collaboration with IAEA, and Chairman K.N. Vyas in the last general conference of the IAEA said that out of in the period 2018-19, they organized, the global center organized 19 programs, and 8 of them were jointly organized with the International Atomic Energy Agency. See, Atmanirbharta doesn't mean you should cut off yourself from international cooperation. It's just not done. It's not. No, maybe in a slide I will show you. Self-reliance, I defined when I was Director of BARC, as immunity against technology denial. We are building a complex system, and if some subsystem is available to you from outside, from a reliable source, Go ahead and put it. Don't waste your time developing that. But if anything is denied to you, including the proverbial wheel, you must have the capability to do it yourself. That is what is meant by self-reliance. That's what all countries do. And in science, many problems in science, origin of the universe, ultimate structure of matter, or very high technology projects like thermonuclear fusion. No one country can do it in the world. And so we collaborate with other countries. This is a picture from the Large Hadron Collider, which made sensational news some years back for having discovered the Higgs boson, which was a missing particle in the Standard Model. See, the origin of the universe and the Big Bang theory, the Higgs field is the one that is supposed to give masses to all the particles that were created. And boson is named after Satyendranath Bose. There are only two kinds of fundamental particles, fermions and bosons. If the particle has a spin half, it is named, it's called fermion, named after Enrico Fermi, who built the first reactor, Italian, who built the first reactor in Chicago. Boson was Satyendranath Bose. If any particle has spin zero, like the photon, or integral spin, it's called a boson. Higgs boson, see, that's why it's called the Higgs boson, became a little more sensational. As for some strange reason, they got it, called it the God particle. And the first signature of this came from a detector called the CMS, Compact Muon Solenoid. And that detector, we had a collaboration from Tata Institute of Fundamental Research. See, the way this experiment is done is in a tunnel below the ground, 100 meters below the ground. Protons or hadrons are moving around in circles 26 kilometers in circumference in opposite directions. Since it's a charged particle, it can be bent by a dipole magnet. Once in a while, they are brought together. And when they collide, energy disappears. I told you, E is equal to mc squared. M disappears, you produce nuclear energy. But if E disappears, you produce mass, that means new particles. And the higher the colliding energies of the particles, the higher is the masses of the new particles that you can produce. And this circle, as it goes around, they have to take it to 4 tera electron volts, it can go higher. Tera electron volt, million, billion tera. In order to produce this Higgs boson, which has a mass something like 130 to 150 times the mass of the proton. As I said, the particle, the protons are bent by dipole magnets, but are focused by superconducting corrector magnets. Sextupole, octupole, decapole, 1,800 of them, worth $40 million estimated at European cost. All those were supplied by India. Department of Atomic Energy to Raja Ramana Center for Atomic Research, made by an Indian company. So we are part of something very basic to understand the ultimate structure of matter. And we are gone for international collaboration. Similarly, in fusion energy, thermonuclear fusion, no one country can do it. This is a project called ITER, International Thermonuclear Experimental Reactor, coming up in France. We are a member of that. Not, we don't give cash, we give in kind. And this happens in a donut-shaped particle in a chamber. And that is called the tokamak. It's a Russian design. You know, the protons, they don't like to come near the isotopes of energy. DND, DNT, deuteron and triton, diuteron and deuteron, because they are electrostatically electrostatic repulsion between them. Both are positively charged particles. If you go on and make a plasma out of that and go on increasing the temperature to 50-100 million degrees, then by sheer kinetic energy, they are forced to come near each other. That means the fusion cross-section is a function of temperature, becomes significant only at that kind of temperature. Of course, when you are talking of that kind of temperature, there is no vessel which can contain it. Containment can be done only by a magnetic field, and it has to happen at a low temperature. And the cryostat, which houses the entire tokamak, is 30 meters in diameter and 30 meters in height. That was built by a company in India under the supervision of the Institute of Plasma Research in Gandhinagar, near Ahmedabad, Gandhinagar. And in fact, IPR is our partner on behalf, it's part of Department of Atomic Energy. It's part of the ITER program. They had a conference there, fusion energy conference, a couple of years back. And I inaugurated that. And they are expecting this 500 megawatt reactor to go to power by 2030s. That's what Bernard Bigot, the DG of ITER, was. It's a fascinating physics. But fusion technology is a big challenge, is what I said in my inaugural letter. Of course, we are very proud of our space program, which also has a very big center in Ahmedabad, ISRO, BRL. And they have launched so many satellites, 100 satellite, CartoSat 2 series, and Robust Polar. Now they can launch geostationary. They have plans, Chandrayaan 2, and then Gaganyaan. And there also, you see, all our communities, webinar is possible because we have satellite communication provided by these satellites. But they have can do remote sensing satellites. They can do forest mapping. They can help in watershed development. They can do crop system analysis. They can identify pest attack very early. And this is very interesting application, potential fishing zones. They can tell the fisherman which side the shoal of fish is moving. And there is a mobile app provided by this lab, remote sensing lab in Hyderabad, which they can decide which direction to go for. So sustainable development, it is also possible, very much so actually, using nuclear and high technology programs like nuclear and space. See, one of the problems in India is to enhance academia-industry interactions, research, development, delivery. As Kenan Sahin says, academic institutions are good in research, companies are good in delivery, both are poor in development. So when I was the PSA, we set up a number of advisory groups, each specific sector. Automotive was very successful. And you do machine tools. And in fact, we funded what I call a catalytic project in IIT Madras under Professor Ramesh Babu. And one of the companies there, Micromatic Machine Tools, and they built the world's best grinding machine tool. And this is what is shown, what you see in the picture. In fact, this has been so successful that the Ministry of Heavy Industries have given them something like 50-100 crore project to set up a center for advanced manufacturing with a dozen projects in which 80-20 partnership, 20% of the money comes from industry, so that the industry use is automatically guaranteed. And of course, the intellectual property will rest with the academic institution. As I said, India's technology needs range from nuclear to rural. And this I started when I was the PSA, something like 2004. It's an open platform, demand-driven innovation strategy for rural technology development, centered in 7 IITs, but number of other academic institutions are involved, and of course other R&D institutions like BRC or DRDO institutions are also involved in that. For example, in this, when I was in, there is a term which was coined by a couple of Harvard Business School guys. I've given them Hargadon and Sutton. They defined a term called knowledge brokering. What they say is most innovations use old ideas as the raw materials for one new idea after another. We call their strategy knowledge brokering. They give an example of the steamboat, which is a steam engine. But steam engines were being used in mines for 75 years before that. So one man got an idea that why can't you use it for sea transport? You know, when I was in Pune, the defense lab there showed me the bridges, collapsible bridges they were making for our troops to move into enemy territory, and also even tanks can move. So I thought, why not do some knowledge brokering? So at that time, the Uttarakhand floods had occurred, and a lot of areas had been cut across. But then they built this one in a Baghi village in Uttarakhand. This is even otherwise, this ravines, there are such numerous ravines in the hilly areas of Uttarakhand. And people have to cross from one end to other to go from their homes to the places where they have agricultural products. And usually it is the women who bring it as a backpack and they cross this ravine. And there is water there. They don't know where they are stepping. And the least thing that can happen to them is they can sprain their ankle. But what, once when this flooding took place, two young women were washed off in these floods. So in collaboration with Dr. Anil Joshi, with whom we work, of HESCO, Himalayan Environmental Studies and Conservation Organization, we means the PSA's office at that time, 2000. No, not 2000. This was in 10 years back. The bridge was built. And now they are very, very happy, the villagers. In fact, we called it the Women's Bridge. See, today we need connectivity. The National Knowledge Network, which is run by MITI, and NIC, National Informatics Center, is part of MITI. And this proposal came actually when I was the PSA and was accepted by the Prime Minister's office then. And they have built this wonderful network, which is now, which is a research and education network, the biggest in the world today, which connects 1,600 institutions in the country, knowledge institutions, and highly reliable, scalable network, because multiple connectivities are involved here. And it is connected to some of the major networks in the world, like the internet of the USA, Giant of France, all the sun data I showed you, Large Hadron Collider, that data came live because the sun grid was connected to the NKN and came to the Tata Institute of Fundamental Research. But if you can, within this, you can create grids so that people are working in specific areas, high energy physics or climate change, whatever, can subgroups out of this can do that. And you can also do a remote experiment. My friend Hosur has used the the synchrotron source in Grenoble, sitting in Bombay, using this kind of connectivity. Of course, there are other areas which we should look at. for sustainable development. These look like very high-tech areas, but sustainable development can be badly damaged. We don't use new techniques which are coming, like cybersecurity and artificial intelligence. And we have, of course, firewalls, intrusion detection, preventions, and all other kinds of antivirus software is there. But criminals are also leveraging social media for their own gain. And we have to be very careful on the. Of course, people are very much aware, a lot of programs in India on this, and then artificial intelligence. Normally, when we talk of AI, we think of intelligence displayed by systems of a type normally associated with human beings. Could be computers, robots, slave manipulators used in bar. AI research too. One, trying to replace human intelligence by analyzing cognition, which is the example I gave there. The other one is to mimic the structure and functioning of the brain. And in deep learning, these artificial neural networks, as they are called, are used to recognize patterns in various types of computer representations, interpretations of big data. You know, all these are related: artificial intelligence, machine learning, big data analytics. And they are being used from all areas, from commerce to cybersecurity. Of course, some people are scared of this, like Stephen Hawking, who, the great astrophysics guy, worked from a wheelchair and did such wonderful physics. You develop it fully, it is well the end of the human race. Yeah, but I don't agree with that, but I agree with Roger Penrose, who says that humans will always be smarter than computers and computer algorithms and any other cybernetic machines that they create. I agree with that. And of course, then one can go into more detail. What do you mean by intelligence? For example, interpersonal intelligence, intrapersonal, naturalistic, not to go into spiritual existential. Can machine ever have that? I'm coming to the end of my talk. You know, Alvin Toffler, the famous futurologist, once said, "Yesterday, violence was power. Today, wealth is power. And tomorrow, knowledge will be power." I paraphrase that to say, today, knowledge is power. Because all the sources of power he talks about are related to technology one way or another. And that is why countries and companies try to dominate technology in two methods: intellectual property rights and technology control regimes. Now, if we want India to be a global technology leader, we should be in the forefront of creating intellectual property rights, and we should make yourself immune to technology control regimes, like we did in the case of the nuclear I was trying to explain to you. So this is what I said when I was director of BARC. I mentioned it briefly. Dominant development of self-reliance and immunity against technological denial in high technology areas. I mentioned about risk taking. After due analysis, after taking account of the benefit that you will get from it, visibility, all that you do, but you should have the ambition to be the first introducer of new advanced technologies. Very often there are people who talk about, oh, let us go for proven technologies. And I say, proven technologies are often a synonym for obsolete technology. The more you prove them, the more obsolete they become. Of course, the technology can evolve with time. Evolutionary, then that is not where this is. You can't wait. You can't hang on to the coattails of the leading countries in the world. I'm sure you young guys want India to be a leader, not just a follower hanging on to the coattails of already developed countries. course, we need a technology superstructure, but we should not forget, and this is where the universities come in a big way. The foundation for the technology superstructure is laid by basic research. Otherwise, there are many examples. You know, somebody asks you, it'll give you some example of technology, this one, how the importance of basic research in creating a technology superstructure. Let me say one word about the founder of our atomic energy program, Dr. Homi Bhabha. And Dr. Homi Bhabha was not just a great leader, but you know, very often when a leader goes away, and Bhabha died in a tragic air crash, the whole system he has created collapses. But what Bhabha did was he created a leadership swarm around him. Collected together some of the top brains, sometimes from abroad. Of course, same thing he did in Tata Institute of Fundamental Research. The best mathematics department is in Tata Institute of Fundamental Research. Homi Sethna, chemical engineering, Rajaramanna, physics, Brahm Prakash, metallurgy, A.S. Rao, electronics. And so that, of course, it is a tragic loss when he died. But the system recovered very fast. And it also helped to create so many more leaders in the following generations. Let me conclude with telling you something. There is a famous guy, writer called Arthur Koestler. He says there are two kinds of leaders, the yogi and the commissar. The yogi is the contemplative thinker. Commissar is the man of action. Of course, all of us are part this and part that. Fractions may vary. Bhabha was a unique mixture of both. To affront, to insult mathematics, one would have to say he was 100% yogi and 100% Kamisa. Of course, he was followed by Dr. Vikram Sarabhai, who took care of Department of Atomic Energy for a little while, and then was the father of the space program. And he also had this great technology foresight. Like Bhabha thought of building nuclear reactors at a time India was not even building bicycles indigenously. Time has come to say thank you as far as my talk is concerned.
Thank you so much, sir. It was a great, insightful talk. Your knowledge and experience really shine like a lamp, and we are really grateful to be enlightened by your talk. Now, with your kind permission, I would like to open up the session for question and answers. Many of the participants have been waiting and are eager to get the answers.
Sure.
So the first question goes this way. Is there any data available on the what portion of nuclear fuel is used for energy generation to that used in weapons?
No, the weapon is a very small part. Weapon. See, we use plutonium. That comes out of a nuclear reactor only. The nuclear reactor, heavy water reactor in our case. Uranium-238 gets converted to 239. It's a very, very small fraction of what is used for nuclear power. And even plutonium can be used in our submarines, in our fast breeder reactors. Of course, I mentioned that to you.
And so, as we know that you are very close to APJ Abdul Kalam, and yesterday only it was his birth anniversary. So we would like to know if you could share some sweet memories with him.
See, actually, there was one brief interaction a long time back. And then really we became close to each other when I became chairman of Atomic Energy Commission. And he was the head of the DRDO organization, scientific advisor to Raksha Mantri. The first interaction was before you were born, or maybe your mother was born, Prachi.
Yes.
This was in 1970. I was discussing with Dr. Sarabhai that I was looking for fast detonators for the Pokhran 1, 1974, when we were designing the peaceful nuclear explosive at that time. And Sarabhai, when I met him in his house in APNC Road, that's in Bombay, he said there is a young man in the Trivandrum, that was the space center was in Trivandrum, who is working on detonators. And you come with me next time I go there, I will introduce him to him. So I went with him, because he went there for the meeting of the scientific council of the center, which is now called Vikram Sarabhai Space Center. And that young man turned out to be Kalam. And of course, it didn't work out because the kind of detonators they were using for separating stages in the space vehicles, which was 1,000 times slower than what I wanted. I wanted sub-microsecond detonators. Then we got it done through DRDO. That was my first interaction. Then, of course, we have had chats around. Once I was traveling with him to Russia for some, in a flight, and he told me an interesting story about his, I think, grandfather. Now, they are from Rameshwaram, which is a holy Indian town. And the you know, in temples, there are two. One, which is stationary in the Garbhagraha, and the other one is moved around. Normally it moves around on land. In Rameshwaram, it moves around in a boat in their temple tank. And Kalam told me that once that the boat toppled, and the first man who dived into the water to pick it up was Kalam's grandfather. So even today, he told me that, you know, in temples, there is what they do. In Tamil, we call it Mudal Mariyade, the first respect, right? That right belongs to Kalam's family in the Rameshwaram. Then I told him a story. You know, my early education was in Meerut. And there I heard this story is based in Meerut during pre-partition days when there was bad riots and all that. And in that place, there was a two-year-old child which drifted off from the house when the others were doing whatever they were doing. After some time, they found the child was missing. They searched here and there and called the police, nothing happened, they couldn't find him. Finally, the child was returned to the family by an anonymous Muslim gentleman. I told the story in Dehradun. No, then they were felicitating us after the Pokhran test. And I told them, but for that kind old anonymous Muslim gentleman, you would have a new chairman of the Atomic Energy Commission today. Because the child was me. I told the story too. So this is the real India. You know, when you talk of all kinds of... anyway, let us not get into politics. Science. Back to science.
Yes. Our team members would also like to ask you a few questions.
Yes.
The first one by Jeffy.
Hello, good evening, sir. I'm Jeffy.
Jeffy, now I'm seeing you for the first time. We have been talking.
Okay, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
I think Gigi has seen you, of course. Oh, perhaps. No. This is Jeffy. Yeah. Go ahead.
Yes, sir. So my question is that last year it was said by the Department of Atomic Energy that by 2031 we will have 21 new nuclear reactors.
Yeah.
So what will be our major strength after that?
What is the
our major strength, like by 2031, year 2031, we will have.
You see, I showed you the slides on the reactors under construction at the moment.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
1,800 megawatts. No. Any kind of power plant, it depends on how much funds they will get, the money they will get. A lot of projects are in various stages of execution. And once the money comes, they will be built. Because they have plans, including the imported reactors, of building that will go well way beyond 2030. That will include the new fast beta reactors, the new light water reactors. It will go up to 50,000 megawatts at some stage. But when we will reach 30,000 megawatts or 50,000 megawatts will depend upon how much funds become available. Because there is a fund availability. Important is the government realizes. Good thing is they have given us a clearance for 10 reactors, 700 megawatts, to be built in a fleet mode. That is, you can give orders for reactors. See, companies don't like to normally take up, one reactor at a time. Then how can we set up assembly line and all that? So the first time. So I think it is very promising. But the numbers, you can guess some numbers. But I've given you what is the plan. What kind of reactors were planning in various countries where imports is concerned. The 4 more reactors, 2 already on with the Russians, and then 10 700 megawatt reactors, then fast beta reactors. We will change the fuel as we go along. Right now it is mixed oxide fuel. They are doing research to take it to metal, because there they want to look at experience and improve the breeding ratio. That is how much more that you have produced, so that the doubling time becomes faster. So all these will be taken into account, and hopefully we'll get the money. Like you young guys, I'm also optimistic. Okay.
Thank you, sir.
So next question is from Rishabh.
Yes.
Namaskaram, sir. Sir, I am Rishabh Parikh from Civil Department of Faculty of Technology.
Almost I heard it as Rishabh Pant. I was thinking, what is he doing here and not playing cricket in Sharjah or Dubai or something? Rishabh Parikh, okay, go ahead.
Yes, sir. I am studying in Civil Department, sir. And I have a little question in my mind, sir. As you even mentioned that India is right now world's biggest reservoir for thorium. And it's fortunate that we are having it. Then, sir, why we are lagging behind in producing energy or producing electricity from these, from nuclear reactions or from atomic reactions? Are we lacking our fundings, or are we lacking kind of infrastructure?
See, the thing is, as I telling J.P. Johnson, first is money. Whatever reactor, whatever, whether it's a thermal power plant, whether it is any other kind of, you need money. That's one part of it. But coming to your interesting question of thorium, thorium comes in the third stage. See, firstly, our fast breeder program must get into high gear. We must start building a fleet of fast breeder reactors. Thorium by itself is not a fissile fuel. Thorium has to be converted to uranium-233. And yes, that conversion will take place in the fast breeder reactors. So once substantial quantities of thorium begin to become available, meanwhile, we will improve the design of these reactors, thorium reactors. Mm-hmm. Can we use molten salt, for instance? There's a good idea going around, so that you don't take it out, reprocess and put back, but do it in a flow method. That is, all those ideas are being tried out, and various other kinds of reactors for various purposes are being worked out. But thorium will come in the longer term, but not in the short term.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Sir, as mentioned by you, that closed nuclear fuel cycle with thorium-233 added becomes effectively near renewable energy. And the current drawback is economy, as you said. So once we become economically efficient, how will this near renewable energy bring revolutionary changes?
See, economics is not that simple. You know, like in your own house, if you have money, you can use it to give better education to your child, you can go for building a house, or you can buy a car. Now, and in all activities in a family, like in any stable system, there is a thermodynamic equilibrium among various activities. Now, you have to remove poverty. You have to take care of the damage now done by the COVID, which may last, economic damage may last a little more time. I was in another meeting with the Jal Shakti Minister. A little while, 3 o'clock, that was the meeting in IIT Jodhpur, which was on the webinar. You want safe drinking water for everybody, water, produce water. For that, you need desalination, which you can also do nuclear desalination. Then you want good housing. Prime Minister wants housing for everybody. And energy is one, as you thermodynamically equilibrate all these things. You see, I showed you the curve. Per capita electricity consumption plotted against the Human Development Index. Human development requires a number of parameters. And this one, as it grows, hopefully, it is the driver of growth in other areas. Energy, electricity is the driver of growth for others. So it should get the priority. And you know, as time goes on and this climate change becomes more severe, and you know, renewable energy is very, very important. But then it is intermittent. It's okay when the sun is there. When the sun is not there, the wind is not blowing. What do? You need a base level energy. Of course, you can put it into a grid whenever you have. You can add hydro. You can do hybrids. For example, you use solar energy to pump water up, small micro hydel plants even. Whenever sun is there, you pump up the water. Sun is not there, not to worry. But hydel plant can give you sustained power. And in this, you see, normally nuclear power is used for base load. If you cut off the water, hydropower disappears. That's very easy. You shut off the fueling to a thermal plant, you can cut down the operation thermal plant. Nuclear reactor, to shut it down, it takes a little time and to start it up. So normally, nuclear reactor are operated as base load also. But it is very clear that the whole world is now has to take into account. If you want to develop, you need electricity. You want to take care of climate change, you must go for nuclear in a big way. How it will work out will also depend on how well India grows. You know, demand is also dependent on growth. Of course, we are all hoping that we'll reach double-digit growth. This is a setback. This is temporary setback due to this COVID pandemic.
So the next question is, how do we see nuclear deterrence of India making more bombs or weapons? Isn't factor of safety of nuclear energy systems too low? So much stress in handling and risking if any disaster occurs.
You see, nuclear safety is, India was one of the leaders in nuclear safety. And you know, the high level radioactive waste is the one worries about. And that you can immobilize the waste. See, if you are drinking water from a glass, did you drink water from a glass during the meeting? No, you didn't drink. Somebody drank, not this summer, then maybe the previous meeting. You are not worried glass particles are going into your stomach, right? when water goes past glass, it doesn't leach the glass. So in our BRC, we have produced special kinds of borosilicate glasses, which are 10 times less leachable than ordinary glass that you use. And this high radioactive waste is parked inside those glasses. And after a due period of time, the highest level radioactivity, of course, you have removed when you took plutonium out of it. And then you have to, long term, after interim storage, you have to bury it underground in places where it doesn't come into contact with water, in spite of our very low leachability vitreous form in which you have done that. The nuclear deterrence is the other part of the question was nuclear deterrence. You know, I've always said national development and national security are two sides of the same coin. Development without security is vulnerable. Security without development, meaningless. The greatest advantage of recognized strength is that you don't have to use it. That is why when I talk to college audiences, I tell the girls to learn self-defense. If the undesirable fellow knows that this girl can give him a karate chop at a sensitive point, he will not bother. If the this and this, that is retaliatory deterrence. He won't even come near you. That is preventive deterrence. There is no difference between this and nuclear deterrence. If you are strong enough, the greatest advantage of recognized strength is that you don't want to use it. You don't have to use it. That is, and India is strong. Anybody bothers us, that's what our nuclear doctrine says. We will give them kind of overwhelming damage will be caused to the enemy. He attacks our country, our assets, or our people. Now the other guy will think before. That is deterrence. Nuclear weapons normally are not discussed like other weapons for common use. They are for deterrence.
Okay, and
yes, Prachi.
Yes, sir. Probably the last question of this evening. For sustainable development of a country, each and every person of that country has a key role in their part. Accordingly, what will be the key role of young talents for the same?
It's a very good statement. You know, everybody, including young people, want change. But who did it? Gandhiji, who said, you must be the change. You change. You create the change. And as we develop, all of us have to contribute, particularly the young people, particularly the talented young people, from some of whom will come out the leaders of future India. And you know, I always like to quote the great Einstein. Einstein once said, somebody asked him, what is it that makes a great scientist? And his reply is interesting. He said, people think it is intellect. They are wrong. It is the character. Not that anybody can do great science, but if the scientist lacks integrity, and he can never become a great scientist. But this is something which is applicable to everybody. I want all young people to have character. Swami Vivekananda once said, 100 years back, the great man said, the old theology was, you are an atheist if you don't believe in God. Today, the new theology is, you are an atheist if you don't believe in yourself. For there are shades of Advaita Vedanta here in which Swami Vivekananda was a believer. Self-belief. All of you young guys must have self-belief. In you and in your country. Baba had that. As I said, we thought of building reactors at a time we were not even building bicycles indigenously. That is not only great technology foresight, but self-belief. Not just in yourself, but in other people, other Indians, because we must work together. And lastly, all of us, young people, we must be optimistic. Sometimes things will come which don't look good. Just ignore them. Go ahead. Optimistic about yourself and about your country. Lastly, you must have passion. Young people. Not that old people shouldn't be passionate, but young people, since you are asking, should be passionate about doing great things for themselves and for India, our country.
Thank you. And if you permit, sir, we can take one last question and then we'll proceed towards the closing. So the question is, does India prioritize energy generation over weapons?
See, India does prioritize, of course it prioritizes, and you must, Planning Commission has a role for, definite role for nuclear energy. But of course you won't build a nuclear power plant near a coal mine or near when you can build a big dam is there. There you may go for hydroelectric. So it is also region-wise. But our energy demands, you know, I'm talking of increasing per capita electricity consumption by 5 times. Talking of a huge increase. So all energy options are important for India. During renewable energy, Prime Minister has taken this very big international solar alliance initiative. Big projects are coming up, particularly in Gujarat. I read about Gujarat and Rajasthan, Adani Green Energy building. A huge thing also including building the components for this one. So there is obviously a plan which is region specific and requirements. And then slowly the planning also begins to take into account base load, variable load. But at this point of time, whatever you produce is consumed in the country. Yes. Energy, electricity, hungry. This point. And of course, somebody has to find the money for building this plant. That is the.
So, thank you so much, sir, for responding to the questions. Oh, now,
Prachi, can I ask a small question?
Yes, go ahead. I don't mind.
Sir, thank you so much for a very, very nice and illuminating lecture for our students. You said in the beginning, that to one of your Western friends, you told that we need you in short run, whereas you are going to need us in a long run. So can you shortly, in a brief, elaborate this?
This is a general principle. Yeah. You see, if any technology, advanced technology particularly, if there is discontinuity, knowledge begins to attenuate. See, that's why if you have a very important area, one must make sure that somebody is there with you who is learning all that you know. Okay. Learning all you know. Now, suppose this, you start funding that technology for a certain period of time. There are no young people who are getting attached to this fellow. See, knowledge goes beyond what is there in documents. And what is there in the experimental equipment. There's a lot of knowledge which only the, I was going to tell a story. Prachi, is there time for a story also?
Sure, sir.
Are you running out of time?
No. Sir.
No, you are not. You see, in the Manhattan Project, the Americans, they tried to solidify plutonium. This textbook stuff, I'm not telling you anything which is published by Los Alamos Science. Now, plutonium is a very strange metal. It has half a dozen phase transitions. When it solidifies at about 300, It is in what we call the delta phase. 15 gram per cc. 15 gram per cc. Then you bring it to room temperature. It goes to alpha phase. 19 gram per cc. Now, if you solidify something at a lower density and take it to higher density, it will become porous and brittle. Cannot be used in the weapon. They tried all kinds of method. Solidifying under pressure didn't work. So finally they went to Cyril Stanley Smith, a metallurgist, great metallurgist. And they asked him this problem, what do we do? He was not designing a weapon. He said, put 3% gallium, it will never go to alpha phase. 3%. Because he has studied the phase diagrams of actinides, not plutonium in particular. And this comes from his experience. In the same way, the older guys have knowledge which is not put down in documents or from visible from experiments. Now, if you don't allow that group to grow and want to restart that technology, you have a big problem. So the joke I was having with my Western friends, while you are not building nuclear power plants for a long time, and all the people with knowledge and experience are retiring, no young people are joining. The only two countries with very active nuclear power programs are India and China. And now if you want to restart it, well, you have got to come to us. That's what I meant in the long term, you will come. A very generic statement on high technology. Don't allow any technology, high technology, advanced technology, to kind of attenuate without having. Anyway, I've finished that question, please.
Okay. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you so much, sir. Now I would like to heartily welcome the Registrar of Maharaja Sayajirao University of Baroda, Dr. K.N. Chudasma, and I would request him to say the vote of thanks.
Namaskar, sir.
Namaskar.
First of all, I would like to apologize. I couldn't, I was not visible in the beginning of the session, but I was very much present as an attendee.
Thank you for that. Thank you.
I take the credit of listening the entire session because I am a person of economics, and initially I thought that why didn't I opt for physics, because if the person of physics is making economics so interesting. So many thanks, and my heartily gratefulness for blending the entire session into so fruitful input for my students. It was so much comprehensive as well as so much lucid in terms of understanding, and I really enjoyed, despite not being a person of physics, I enjoyed each and every concept and the way in which you explained it. And on behalf of the student staff, Senate, Syndicate, and on behalf of Vice Chancellor and Chancellor of the Maharaja Sayajirao University of Baroda, I take this opportunity to wholeheartedly thank the today's speaker, Honorable Chidambaram sir, and his inputs have really helped me a lot. So I'm very much sure that the students of the Faculty of Engineering and Technology would definitely have enjoyed much more than me, because there was not a single statement which I couldn't understand. The only thing was, if I could have the knowledge of physics, it would have become the ice on the cake. So I was finding so much of interest in how he linked the society, economics, as well as the contemporary world, not only that, but political economy also, as well as the energy and various kind of resource allocation. So when a layman who is not from the background of physics is finding it interesting, I am very much sure that it has been really very fruitful to the students as well as the attendees, those who are attending this webinar. Once again, I wholeheartedly thank you, sir. And COVID has presented us an opportunity to witness you by an online session or a webinar. But we would be grateful and really glad to have you after the post-COVID situation to visit MS University physically. And we would like to have a series of input sessions from you if your health and time permits you. Once again, I thank on behalf of the Maharaja Sayajirao University of Baroda family. Thanks for joining us, spending your time with us and making the entire session so so fruitful and with so much of interest. And he's, you know, students must be saying that he's really cool, because the kind of the way of his narration is there, that has been very nice, sir. So thanks a lot for once and for all, and wish you a very good health, as well as we would be glad to have inputs from you time and again from your side with your all the ideas and with all your concerns, sir. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you, sir. I also enjoyed the discussions, and thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir. On the behalf of Team Paramarsh, I would like to take this opportunity to thank you for enlightening us with such a wonderful knowledge. And it was really great to have you on board, sir.
Thank you, Prashant.
Thank you, sir.